Recording.
All right. So the canon law on the Eucharist is given in canons 897 onwards, the third sacrament. As you know, there are three sacraments of initiation: baptism, confirmation, and the Eucharist. So in this class, we are going to study what the law of the church says about the Holy Eucharist. I have been telling you in earlier classes, the first canon of each of the sacraments gives in a summary form the whole theology of the sacrament. What you study in systematic theology classes for so many hours is summarized and given in the first canon of each of the sacraments. So each expression will be a treatise for you in the class. But here you will see, when you read the canon, even if you don't know the whole of the Eucharist Father taught you, if you know this canon, at least you know in summary form what is Eucharist. So let us just look at canon 897. The most august sacrament is the Blessed Eucharist. So the word superlative is used, august and most august sacrament. So all sacraments are important, but other sacraments are celebrated in the context of the Eucharist. The total offering of Christ is there. So in the Holy Mass only, as you know, many of the sacraments are recommended to be celebrated. So it speaks about the most august sacrament. Then it speaks about Christ the Lord himself is contained. You have studied about real presence of the Lord, isn't it? So Christ the Lord himself is contained in the Eucharist. That is the second expression. After saying Eucharist is the most august sacrament, it says Christ is contained in the Eucharist. Look at the next expression. Christ is offered in the Eucharist. Christ is offered to the Father by the whole Christian community, especially by the priest. Christ is offered. See the next verb. Christ is received. So Christ is contained, Christ is offered, and Christ is received during the distribution of the Holy Communion. Look at the next expression. By the Eucharist, the church continually lives and grows. Someone said, baptism increases the church in number, but the Eucharist increases the church in quality. The church lives and grows by the Eucharist. Then, Eucharistic sacrifice. See the other, each of the topic that the professor would have taught, that the subject is taught. By the Eucharistic sacrifice, the Eucharistic sacrifice is the memorial of the death and resurrection of the Lord, in which the sacrifice of the cross is ever perpetuated. Every time we celebrate the Eucharist, we think of the death and resurrection of the Lord. So that's why it is the memorial of the death and resurrection of the Lord, in which the sacrifice of the cross is ever perpetuated. And it is the summit and source of all worship and Christian life. Summit and source of all worship and Christian life. So, you know, law of the church in 276 says that the priests or clerics are obliged to pray the liturgy of the house. 276, para 26. But then with regard to the Mass, Holy Mass, it says they are recommended to celebrate the Holy Mass daily. But as you know, many priests celebrate the Mass daily but don't pray one. Here it is said because people feel it is the summit of all worship. So if I miss Mass, I am so sad. But if I don't pray, I am not that sad. But actually we should be more sad if you don't pray. But which is the best form of prayer? Of course, it is the Holy Eucharist. So the canon says it is the summit and the source of all worship and Christian life. And then see the other theological treatise. By means of the Eucharist, the unity of God's people is signified. Many grains form one bread. Many grapes form one bottle of wine. Like that, the unity of the people of God is signified in the Eucharist. So St. Paul says, if you come there, and then if you are divided, there is no meaning of celebrating the Holy Eucharist. By Eucharist, we are united also. And then the building up of the body of Christ, that means the people of God are built up and perfected. And then the last statement, the other sacraments and all the ecclesial works of the apostolate are bound up, are linked with and directed to the Blessed Eucharist. What more you can say in a summary form, the whole treatise of the Eucharist. All other sacraments are linked to the Eucharist and they are bound up to the Eucharist. They are directed to the Eucharist. For example, you might have heard how Mother Teresa said to one of the novices, "My dear daughter, you know how the priest was holding the consecrated host devoutly in his hand. When you are going to give bath to this elderly man who is invalid, you have to hold the man with the same devotion." Mother Teresa said, "Where do I get all my strength? It is all from the Eucharistic Lord. All from the Eucharistic Lord." So when they asked her to start a convent in Russia, though the government was opposed to allowing priests, they had to yield because Mother Teresa said, without Eucharist we cannot have the community to serve the abandoned people. So because of Mother Teresa, some of the places priests were allowed unwillingly by the governments which were opposed to Christianity. All strength is derived, all apostolate is directed. Every time we think of the crucified Lord, it brings about unity, it signifies sharing. Christ is contained, offered and received. Most of the sacrament, other sacrament do not have any much of significance without the Eucharist. Everything is contained there. I'm not teaching as a theologian, but then just reading the canon and recapitulating what you might have already learned. Okay, we go to the next canon. So, what is the threefold obligation of the people of God towards the Eucharist? Threefold obligations. Three things. The first one is, of course, they have to participate in the Mass devoutly. Participate in the Mass devoutly. So, that is very important as seminarians. You have to participate devoutly. If you are keeping awake too long in the night, how can you participate in the Mass devoutly? That's why there is a rule that you have to go to bed in time. Body will take its own revenge. When you are only physically present, mentally and spiritually not so alert, not only in the class, but also in the chapel, especially during Mass, it is not good. It is the fundamental obligation of all Christians to participate in the Mass devoutly. Even later on as a priest, whole night you was traveling and morning you have not prepared much of the homily. Physically you are not alert. Naturally it takes its toll on the meaningful celebration of the Holy Eucharist. Occasionally you may have to travel the whole night. Some priests have it as a regular basis. They are tired and make the people tired. So, first obligation, participate in the Holy Mass devoutly. Participate in it. Secondly, receive the body of the Lord worthily. Receive the body of the Lord worthily. Second obligation. And then, finally, adore the Lord present in the Holy Eucharist. Adore the Lord. So, participation in the Mass, receiving the law and then adoring the law. That's what Canon 898 speaks of. So, three things. In explaining the doctrine of this sacrament, pastors of souls are assiduously to instruct the faithful about the obligation in this regard. Just as I am now instructing you, as teaching catechism, as deacons, as seminarians, and then after becoming priests, tell the people about the significance of the Eucharist. I personally want to tell you, I take every Mass very seriously. I pronounce every word legibly. If you do not have piety, how can you arouse in the people devotion? Very important. How many churches it is written the famous words, O priest of God, celebrate this Mass as the first Mass, last Mass, as the only Mass. As the only Mass. So remember that, for that only you are preparing so long. Afterwards, just doing as a ritual, not with piety, not with devotion, it is not at all good. Okay, we come to the next part, celebration of the Eucharist. There is an introductory canon in chapter 1, again 899, again explaining the theology. What is theology? I need not deal in detail because Father is teaching you, but then just we will go through it. Okay, one of you read Canon 899 para 1, not we must, loudly, because it will be recorded, and then don't make effort, full of yourself. Okay, 899 para 1.
The celebration of the Eucharist is an action of Christ himself and of the church.
So, action of Christ, action of the church. Very good, it is. Action of Christ, action of, not action of the individual. That's why the church are represented. Sometimes some of our seminarians represent the seminary in the inter-sub. They make all kinds of funny activities, are not taking it seriously. My dear brother, you are not playing for yourself. You are representing the seminary. When you don't give your 100%, doesn't matter if you lose. When you don't give your 100%, and you make a mockery of the institution which you represent. That's what I tell them. Here also, Eucharist is the celebration of the church, celebration of Christ himself. What an important teaching then. Then, continue.
In it, Christ the Lord, through the ministry of the priest, offers himself substantially present under the appearances of bread and wine.
Yeah, we already said this. Christ the Lord is present, and then he offers himself, he is substantially present under the appearance of bread and wine. Not only Christ offers himself, but also he is substantially present in the form of bread and wine, which we already saw. Continue.
To God the Father, and gives himself as spiritual nourishment to the faithful who are associated with him in his offering.
Yeah, the offering is to God the Father. The fruit is to the people. The people of God who are associated with Christ, they are nourished. They are nourished. We need material food for our nourishment of the body. We need spiritual food for the nourishment of our souls. Nourishment of our souls. Again, the theology. Then, second paragraph, somebody else.
In the Eucharistic assembly, the people of God are called together under the presidency of the bishop or of a priest under his authority, who acts in the person of Christ.
See, who celebrates the Eucharist? Bishop or priest. So here it says they act in the person of Christ, in persona Christi capitis. They act in the person of Christ. People are called together. Always priest presides. When bishop is there, bishop presides. Second part.
All the faithful present, whether clerics or lay people, unite to participate in their own way. according to their various orders and liturgical roles.
Yes, all the faithful, whether they are clerics or lay, you have to fulfill your role there. This is very important. I am not a liturgy teacher. Follow the liturgical questions as the liturgy professor teaches you. But one thing is, there are clerics. Clerics, as you know, are bishop, priest, and then deacons. They have a role in the Eucharist. Bishop and priest preside and also preach. Deacons can occasionally preach. So the law of the church is, deacons can preach, but when a priest is there, not every time deacon should preach. Sometimes it happens in some parishes, some priests leave always to the deacons. The people, the parishioners want to listen to the parish priest also. Sometimes some deacons are offended, I'm not getting chance every week. Doesn't matter. You prepare the homily every week. Whether you preach or not, you don't bother. You preach in the room. After becoming priest, then you will be preaching loud. Or you preach aloud, go to the garden and then preach. Doesn't matter, don't worry. It is the primary duty of the celebrant to preach. And occasionally, you are asked to preach, that's all. So each according to their role. There are also others, the acolytes. The acolytes have their role. The lector has their role. The cantor has their role. Some of these people should be properly vested and come to the front. Some are said, I will perform my role behind only. Come. You are going to sing the responsorial song. Come. Dressed neatly according to the liturgical. Or don't have all kinds of dress. Your singing is horrible, but your dressing is beautiful. Some of them. So, what is important is, don't try to attract the attention by what you put on external things. Don't try to attract the attention. It should be modest, decent. According to your role, you have to exercise. So, suppose a priest standing in the audience without liturgical vestments, when the words of consecration is said, suddenly raise the hand. You as a priest should not be a layman among the people. You should fully celebrate or celebrate. Priest must be a priest. Cantor must be a cantor. That's what is said clearly. For other things, follow it. So always, you each one should perform the role. Then the last paragraph in that introductory canon. There are three.
The Eucharistic celebration is to be so ordered that all the participants derive from it the many fruits for which Christ the Lord instituted the Eucharistic sacrifice.
Yeah, more possible. All must derive fruit. In this context, you have to facilitate the participation of the whole community. So in the Catholic liturgy, most of the time, the main celebrant has a larger role. Suppose 10% is left for the people. The choir, without minding the others, take 9% of it. Not even 1% is left to the audience. You should never sing a song in which community cannot participate, at least through the chorus. At least through the chorus. Some people say, every time new song. What is important is not the new song always. What is important is whether the whole community is participating in the singing. New songs are welcome, not old ones. But then see to it that the community participates. So without preparing the community, at least for the responsorial song, I don't care for a new song. It is community worship. They are not merely spectators. So 90% for the priest, 9% for the choir, not even 1% for the ordinary people, the vast majority. This cannot happen in non-Catholic churches. Singing means the whole church is singing. They are not worried about new song we have to sing. New song also easy music that everybody can sing. Don't make all people as spectators. All are participants. Participants. Introduce slowly. 5-4 songs are old. One song is new, introduce newly, and then don't sing it and then forget about it. Make it very familiar to the whole community. whole community, that's important. So preparation for the Eucharist. And other things, of course, your liturgy professors and other things, teachers who tell you how you have to make your preparation for the reading. You are not making simply noise to fulfill the obligations. And preparation earlier with regard to the song and so on. At that time only turning the pages, suddenly deciding the song. I cannot preach personally when somebody is turning the pages looking at somewhere. I cannot preach. My thought process will be cut off. Please don't distract. When you are in a ministerial position, doing the cantor, doing the choir master, or in some other service, don't attract the attention from what is happening at the sanctuary through what you are doing, making noise, doing this and that. Participation, devout participation, our thing is important. Okay, now we come to the minister of the Blessed Eucharist. We just go through the canons as it is. As you know, the only minister is the validly ordained priest. Only minister, priest. Sacer dos. The word sacer dos is applicable both to priest and the bishop. Bishop receives the fullness of priesthood and then also priest. If deacons attempt to celebrate Mass, they are suspended. Lay people attempt to celebrate Mass, they are interdicted, means mini excommunication. They should not receive Holy Communion. They should not receive Holy Communion. So, the canon says the only minister who in the person of Christ can bring into being the sacrament of the Eucharist is the validly ordained priest. Validly ordained priest. 10:24 will say, for ordination two things are very important besides the other matter and form. One is you should be male, you should be baptized to receive ordination. Canon 10:24 says like that. So now here, only minister of the Holy Eucharist, celebration of the Holy Eucharist. Don't confuse it with the minister of communion. Who is the minister of communion? It is bishop, priest, deacon, or an extraordinary minister who is afterlife, or any other extraordinary minister. This is simply minister of communion. This is minister of the Holy Eucharistic celebration. Distinguish between that. Who can bring body and blood of Jesus Christ from the bread and wine? It is only the validly ordained priests. After finishing this section, I will give you time for question. Don't worry. We'll just go through fast. Second paragraph. Who can celebrate Mass lawfully? First one is validly. Validly, you must be a priest. Lawfully means Mass is valid, but sometimes you may be unlawfully celebrating. For lawfully celebrating, you should not have been prevented by law. So any priest who is not prevented by canon law may lawfully celebrate the Eucharist, provided the provisions of the following canons are observed. So you follow the liturgical books, you wear the proper vestment, you are not forbidden by your bishop as punishment, suspended. Suppose a suspended priest celebrates Mass, it is valid but then unlawful. Suppose somebody celebrates Mass without any vestment, it is valid but then unlawful, because it's priest, it takes place what needs to take place. So you have to distinguish between first paragraph for validity, second paragraph for lawfulness. Lawfulness. Okay, we should not go too far also. So far, any questions? If you have any questions, on what I spoke. We have not answered everything, the other things come later. In what I spoke so far, any questions? Okay, everything is clear. Okay, we go to the next. Second, 901. A priest is entitled to offer mass for anyone living or dead. So, where the lawgiver has not distinguished, we should not distinguish. Catholic, non-Catholic, baptized, non-baptized, anyone, even for animals, but not for the soul of the animal. They may not. You know the joke about the parish priest was approached. Please celebrate a funeral mass for my dog. Dog? Funeral mass? What are you thinking? But Father, you know, during on that occasion, I want to offer you 10,000 rupees as a donation to the church. My dear brother, why didn't you tell me that it is a Catholic dog? Why didn't you tell me that it is a Catholic dog? When he heard about 10,000 rupees, he was ready to do anything. For the growth of the paddy, you can offer mass. For the growth of the cattle, you can offer mass. Nothing. But no funeral mass for this. Anyone for living or the dead. Okay. We go to the next. 902. Unless the benefit of Christ faithful requires or suggests otherwise, priest may once celebrate the Eucharist. See, in the old law, concelebration was not recommended like here. Concelebration was exception. The new law recommends concelebration. But exceptive class. Suppose people need a mass. Here 10 priests are concelebrating. Nearby only 10 communities are there without anybody to celebrate the Eucharist. Suppose a seminary, we have a priest. Here name is Nirmala Rani. And then Stella marries, they need a priest. No, no, I will only come to celebrate, I will not come here one day for mass. We should not say. People need means we have to help. But otherwise, one celebration is encouraged by Canon 902 in accordance with the theology as manifested in Vatican II. They are, however, fully entitled to celebrate the Eucharist individually. But not while a concelebration is taking place in the same church or oratory. Suppose some brothers are making too much loud music, noise, irritating. When I come there, I lose my patience, I lose my faith also. Suppose I think like that. I have every right to go and celebrate privately. Private mass by the priest is permitted. All have the right. Only that you should not celebrate private mass. When the community is in need, you have to go and celebrate for them. Skipping from the common celebration, you have to, you may celebrate private mass also for the priest. So that's why once they wanted to make a rule here in the seminary, all professors must attend the common celebration. I said, as a canonist, I said, this is against Canon 909. You cannot couple, everybody retains the right. It is encouraged, okay. Every priest retains the right. That's what canon law says. If you want to make the law, but I have to say in at least a low tone that it is against canon 902. All must one celebrate every day, whoever it is. It's good as a community. It has so many values, all right. Sometimes somebody loses the faith. Better not to lose the faith than celebrate alone and grow in the faith. Grow alone, alone in the faith. Of course, the law of the church later on says, when you are celebrating alone, you should have at least one person to participate. Unless that person is leading you into temptation. Or there is a serious reason. Normally, you should not celebrate mass without one person to assist. Without one person to assist. We go to the next. 903. What about somebody claiming himself to be a priest? He comes from outside, I am a priest, Father, I would like to celebrate or come celebrate. So, the priest must prove his identity if you have doubt. So, that's why we always speak of celebrant, a letter from the bishop, which is called as celebrant, can celebrate. Celebrant. Celebrant is a letter attesting that a priest is not debarred from celebrating. that he is a priest and that he is not defiled. So here it says, a priest is to be permitted to celebrate the Eucharist, even if he is not known to the rector of the church, provided either that he presents commendatory letters, that is chalabdar, not more than a year old from his own ordinary or superior, if it is religious priest, superior, or that it can be prudently judged that he is not debarred from celebrating. So he is not a suspended priest, so we allow him to think like that, then you can. Sometimes, even it happened in my diocese, in the cathedral also, some years ago, somebody said that he is a priest, the assistant believed, and then he celebrated and even concelebrated, and then when the assistant went for distributing communion, he emptied the assistant's room and went away. He was not a priest now. He was not a priest now. So, normally we will ask, which seminary father you studied? Who are the classmates? Who was your lecturer? And when you ask that questions only, then we will know whether he is a priest or not. Many of some people believed him and allowed him to celebrate Mass, even though when he was not yet a priest. So you should not be over cautious, but at the same time you should know, you should be prudent in knowing that he is a real priest who is not suspended. Who is not suspended. Okay. The next one, 904. Recommendation for daily celebration. So this most of the priests do. Very few priests do not celebrate daily Mass. So, strict obligation to celebrate Sunday Mass. Strong recommendation to celebrate Mass daily. Daily. That is given in 904. So, you can read it for yourself. Remembering always that in the mystery of the Eucharistic sacrifice, the work of redemption is continually being carried out. The reason is given there. Priests are to celebrate frequently, that means often. Indeed, daily celebration is earnestly recommended. Even if it is not possible to have the faithful present, it is the action of Christ, action of the church. We already said, Holy Eucharist is the action of the church and action of Christ. So, daily celebration. The next one, how many times can you celebrate Mass? So, general rule is one Mass per day. For pastoral needs, bishop can permit two Masses on weekdays and three Masses on Sundays and holy days of obligation. General rule is one Mass per day, whether celebration or concelebration. General rule is. Because they give stipend, you go and celebrate there one Mass, 10 Mass, oh, 500 everywhere, 5000 rupees you earn. No. Nothing like about the stipend, you will know. Even if you celebrate these two Masses, one Mass stipend should go to the diocese or diocesan needs as the bishop prescribes. Even if you celebrate three Masses, you can retain only one Mass stipend. Suppose one Mass you get 500, another 400, another 300. So nothing wrong if you keep for yourself 500. But this 400 and 300 you have to give for the needs of the diocese as the bishop prescribes. Except on Christmas Day. For your dinner, you can have the second Mass money also. Christmas Day is an exception given. Otherwise, the priest is to retain for himself only for one Mass stipend. All the binated or trinated Masses should not be retained by the priest. Binated or trinated. And then bination on weekdays, trination on Sundays allowed by the bishop, but then no fornication, okay? No four Masses. So Father, like this it happens. You have to foresee. This will come, that will come, like that. So you have to foresee whether you have to see, arrange many substitution Father. So celebrate two Masses on Saturday. And then celebrate some three Masses on Sunday. You can celebrate Masses in turn, no problem. But normally you are not allowed to celebrate four Masses. Okay. Then 906, a priest is not permitted to celebrate the Eucharistic sacrifice with the, I already said this, without the participation of at least one of the faithful, unless there is a just reason. Okay, 907. In the celebration of the Eucharist, deacons and laypersons are not permitted to say the prayers which are meant for the celebrating priest. So, for example, it is clearly written, through him, with him, it is only the celebrant and one celebrant. Some deacons join, some priests invite, let us all sing together. All, it is written in red letters. Rubrics means red letter, no? So, red letter, people sing Amen. That is for the people. Even if priest says, you should not. So, Eucharistic prayer, you should not say. It is only the priest. There is one celebrant's part, main celebrant's part. Sometimes it is then, I am also tolerating because I am not able to enforce what they do know. Main celebrant, when it is a marriage mass, one priest sings the preface, another priest says something else of the nuptial blessing, all that we have to distribute, no, like that priests are saying. But when it is put as main celebrant, because of participation, how can you ask each one to take this? There are one celebrant's part that they can take. Collecting the offering they can take. Just to please people sometimes, they are tampering with the liturgical rites. So that's another problem also. Then the next one, 908. We should not one celebrate with non-Catholics. That's very clear. You should not come celebrate with that. Okay. You may have common prayers with them, that is different. But Eucharist, you should not come celebrate with the non-Catholics. Non-Catholics. 909. Prepare yourself for the Mass. Don't get up from the bed and straight away celebrate the Mass. And then remain there for Thanksgiving after Mass. Importance of preparation, importance of thanksgiving. 909. 910. I already taught you this. Who is the ordinary minister of Holy Communion? That is bishop, priest, and deacon. Who is the extraordinary minister, acolyte, or any other lawfully appointed Eucharistic minister? Sisters of the lay people are there. They are all extraordinary ministers. Okay, we finish the next canon also. 910, 911. The duty and right to bring the Blessed Eucharist to seek at Viaticum, primarily that of the parish, parish priest, assistant priest, chaplain. And then if they are clerical, of course they are superiors. In case of necessity, then other priests can also do it, Viaticum, giving the last food for the way. Viaticum means food for the journey. So this is that part. Okay, we have that. Okay? Then we have.